Palmetto police say Freeman's car has been found abandoned in Ashland, Kentucky. Law enforcement there are now questioning two suspects, 21-year-old Kayla Coyler and 26-year-old Roy Nichols Jr., who they say stole that car. Coyler is Trisha Freeman's daughter.
This all happened this morning around 7. Police on the scene say it happened near Desert Inn and Eastern. The driver and passenger of one car were taken to the hospital in critical condition. The suspect in that car will be charged with DUI with substantial bodily harm after he's released from the hospital. The other driver in the second car was not hurt.
CBS 2 cameras captured the aftermath of the shooting on Hollis Avenue and 200th Street. Police say they stopped a suspicious car when the suspect sped off, hitting a police officer. Police later found the car parked 5 minutes away, but the suspects were nowhere to be found. The officer who was hit is expected to be okay.
The Cincinnati Police Homicide Unit is investigating a deadly shooting in Madisonville. The victim has now been identified, Tyrone Frazier. His body found outside a home near the intersection of Rose Street and Jamison Street this afternoon. Frazier was rushed to the hospital where he was pronounced dead. Police tell 9 on Your Side they have identified the shooter.
In Lowell, they've responded to 6 near-fatal overdoses since Thursday. The victim survived only because of the drug Narcan. District attorneys and fire departments are warning people to be particularly careful this St. Patrick's Day weekend. They're encouraging those who know people struggling with drug addiction to make extra phone calls, check in on them, and have Narcan ready.
The last top 5 story this hour, the German foreign minister says now Turkey is away from EU membership more than ever before. Sigmar Gabriel says he always had doubts about Turkey joining the EU. He warned politicians that could be banned from holding rallies in Germany if they failed to abide by German laws. Meanwhile, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan says he hopes Parliament would restore capital punishment. The European Union has warned that Ankara's EU bid will be terminated if it restores the death penalty. The row between Germany and Ankara reached an all-time high after Germany barred Turkish ministers from holding rallies to promote the upcoming referendum in Turkey. The vote is meant to give President Erdogan sweeping powers.
I think the first victory is that Milo Yiannopoulos is not coming to this university, which I think is a good thing.
Yeah. ihr seid es!
I feel as my right and responsibility as a Muslim, as an immigrant, and as a human being, it's my right and responsibility to express my anger at the right-wing rhetoric that's being pursued today. And this is, I think this is just what today is about.
The attacker was shot dead by security forces inside Paris-Orly Airport. He had tried to grab a female soldier's gun when her colleagues on patrol intervened. Soon after, police evacuated thousands of passengers and staff from the south terminal. Eyewitnesses described the panic which followed.
He was holding her by the neck. At the same time, he was holding her arm and he was holding the weapon of the soldier. And then, well, when we realized it was serious, we ran away. We went down the stairs and then we heard two shots.
I looked around. It was full of soldiers. You had people everywhere. Then we got in the hall and we heard gunfire. It was really scary.
The attacker was known to the police and intelligence services. Earlier, he had fired at a police officer north of the capital.
There's been a double attack this morning by the same man, first against a police vehicle. There's been an exchange of gunfire, and there's been a second attack in Orly against the military. I want to pay tribute to the courage and the remarkable behaviour of the security forces who have neutralised the man, doing so in extremely delicate conditions, as it was at Orly Airport.
Airport authorities temporarily suspended all flights. Access roads were blocked, and there was confusion as people tried to reach the terminals.
What police officers have been doing is going from car to car, trying to inform people as to what the situation is. And down there, you can see a long queue of cars. People have been waiting for about 2 hours. Some people say they don't know whether they're going to be able to pick up their relatives. Other people simply have planes to catch.
Despite all the security measures, no one is safe, really. Anyone can just walk into an airport. It can happen anywhere.
We're a bit lost. We know there's been an attack. And thankfully, the security forces reacted fast, but the problem for us is we have a plane to catch.
There have been a series of attacks in France over the past 2 years, and the country's been in a state of emergency since 2015. With the presidential election just 5 weeks away, this incident will throw the spotlight once again on security concerns.
Thank you.
Send a good picture back to Germany, please. Make sure. Very good.
Talk about NATO?
Many things.
Sehr gut. Danke.
Well, Chris, there's one thing we don't see here. It's a handshake. What do you see?
Well, it feeds into the perception, that awkwardness you were talking about between the two of them. If you were in the White House and this was your hope to show that this is a close relationship, perceptually, this did not do it. In the moment where you see Angela Merkel, she's actually, her leg is crossed over and she's leaning and facing toward the president. Yeah. And the president is giving no acknowledgement, almost like a cold shoulder. Perceptually, is it a cold diss? I don't think so in this. If anything, he seems like he's preoccupied. He's in a sprinter's pose. He's up at the front of the chair. He's tapping. We saw this posture when he was sitting with President Obama in the White House, in the Oval Office.
Which is
so it just seems like he's in another place.
And when they
really
yell
focused.
For, I mean, I remember with Prime Minister Abe from Japan, you know, they're yelling for them to shake hands. And do, you know, he's new to this, but he's now been through it before, right?
Yes.
And obviously they still didn't do the handshake.
Are there from time to time tweets that you regret? In hindsight,
very seldom.
Not to have
probably wouldn't
something.
Be here right now, but so very seldom. We have a tremendous group of people that listen, and I can get around the media when the media doesn't tell the truth, so I like that. As far as wiretapping, I guess, by this past administration, at least we have something in common, perhaps. And just to finish your question, we said nothing. All we did was quote a certain very talented legal mind who was the one responsible for saying that on television. I didn't make an opinion on it. That was a statement made by a very talented lawyer on Fox. And so you shouldn't be talking to me. You should be talking to Fox. Okay?
Thank you.
What do you see there?
Well, it's a double-take moment for her, and she'll look over at him and squint her eyes a little bit in a moment of confusion, maybe not exactly sure what he's saying or exactly how to respond to it. And then she returns back to a very calm manner, getting ready for the next question, to be ready for whatever's coming next. But she is slightly surprised by that comment.
I reiterated to Chancellor Merkel my strong support for NATO, as well as the need for our NATO allies to pay their fair share for the cost of defense. And the United States has been treated very, very unfairly by many countries over the years, and that's going to stop. But I'm not an isolationist. I'm a free trader, but I'm also a fair trader.
Es ist ja mehr als fair, dass beide Seiten natürlich die Verträge abschließen, einen Gewinn daraus haben wollen. Und in diesem Geiste würde ich mich freuen, wenn wir die Verhandlungen zwischen der Europäischen Union und den Vereinigten Staaten von Amerika auch wieder aufnehmen könnten.
And how do you think that these nations are going to respond? As you said, that they haven't been sticking to the 2% of GDP that they had basically had the contract, if you want to call it. But let me just ask you one other thing. Is it not, though, the United States that benefits the most from NATO or not? How do you see it?
Well, it's certainly true that NATO is the military muscle of the United States, and it's played a very unfortunate role, for example, in the assault on Libya, totally unjustified, which was contrived by Hillary Clinton, then Secretary of State. I frankly think that NATO is an antiquated concept, but that if Russia, Iran, Syria, China were to organize their own mutual defense pact on the same premise, that an attack on one would be an attack on all, I think we'd have a great deal more stability in the Middle East and other parts of the world than we have today.
Okay, so maybe these countries should then take that cue and actually unite in that way. And the question then would be is if the United States would actually go for that or try to make sure that it doesn't happen. Thank you so much for being with us out of Madison, Wisconsin, Professor James Fetzer.
We should have totally all got off on the right side.
I'm gonna bet my team!
Got it.
Shift fires! Point muscles that way!
The Romanians, if you see through here, with one of our platoons, one of the United States platoons, have a defense set up, and then what's going to happen is in our AAVs, which are amphibious assault vehicles, we're going to conduct an assault from ship to shore and attack the their position.
Defense.
Beach. Main position.
Beach
right here. Yeah, beach will be here. So, my pluton.
Okay, so exercise Spring Storm. It's a bilateral exercise hosted by the Romanian military where they've invited the U.S. to participate. And the purpose of this specific exercise is to enhance our interoperability with amphibious forces.
It's a question about protecting NATO and EU eastern border. We know as well that Russia acting aggressively. Russia is still violating international law.
NATO planning to move around 4,000 troops into northeastern Europe on a rotational basis, focusing on Poland and the Baltic states that fear Moscow could destabilize them.
We're obviously here to reassure our NATO allies, train in a multinational battle group along with the Danish, the French, and obviously underneath an Estonian brigade as well, and get some real good multinational training in so that as NATO as a whole, we're a much better capability.
Russia denying any wrongdoing, describing NATO's behavior as aggressive and threatening.
A year when the Husky-class multipurpose Nicholas submarines of the fifth generation will be constructed has been declared. Enterprises of the United Shipbuilding Corporation are ready to get down to this by 2020, when the Yasin 885 project will have been finished. Before that, Vladimir Dorofeev, Director General of the St. Petersburg Malahitsy Bureau of Engineering, reported that a contract had been signed with the Defense Ministry on development of a fifth-generation multipurpose submarine. Now, the concept of future submarines is being designed. Characteristics of the vessel have not been revealed yet. According to designers, they will depend on requirements of the Russian Navy. As we reported, the Yasin Project 885 presupposes construction of seven multipurpose nuclear submarines. The main one, Severodvinsk, is already in the operational use of the Russian Navy.
According to Reuters, the Russian lower house of parliament, the State Duma, has approved a proposal to launch an investigation into U.S. media organizations that operate in Russia. The investigation will check whether CNN, the Voice of America, Radio Liberty, and other American media are complying with Russian law. The Duma backed the move after Konstantin Zatulin, an MP from the pro-Kremlin United Russia Party, proposed an investigation to retaliate for what he called a repressive U.S. move against Russian state-funded broadcaster RT.
Let's bring in now Jack Barsky. He was a KGB agent. He was spying on the U.S. for a time during close to the end of the Cold War. And that was until he was caught by the FBI. Now he is an American citizen, and he is telling a story in a new book. It's called Deep Undercover: My Secret Life and Tangled Allegiances as a KGB Spy in America. So you can imagine, this is going to be a pretty interesting perspective. Jack, good to have you here this morning. Thank you very much for joining us. You became a spy, of course, for the Kremlin. You were working undercover here in the United States. You're hearing all the allegations that are now being made about the election and how Russia may have tried to influence it. Do you think it is possible that Russia has actually somehow infiltrated the White House?
I don't want to speculate. Anything is possible in the intelligence realm. The bottom line is, when it comes to intelligence matters, the real truth, if it ever comes out, may take 30, 40, 50 years to come out. Like, for instance, what happened in the United States with regard to Soviet spying in the 40s and 50s is now pretty much out in the open, but it took a long time. So today, we will not be able to really find the truth.
All right, so if we can't, say, verify it or prove it right now, is it something, and you would know, is it something that Russia would want to do and has tried in the past?
It absolutely is, but it's exceedingly difficult. You know, the Manchurian candidate, that's fiction. Let's face it. It would require a grand conspiracy, which is nearly impossible to keep secret. When I was undercover, there were about five people who knew about me. Five. And we kept it pretty secret.
Mm-hmm.
I was not involved in these kinds of operations.
I understand.
So I was primarily into political intelligence.
It's the mindset, I guess, I'm going for here.
The mindset, absolutely. If you can, you will probe everywhere you can and find ways to make a little dent here and there. Absolutely, sure.
Okay.
And they have an army of people, who, not only like people who are official employees, but also, you know, collaborators and informants, and that hasn't changed.
Should we be worried as a nation, or just aware and alert?
No, what we should be worried about really is cyber warfare. Cyber warfare is the modern, this is pretty much Cold War 2.0.
And Russia would be willing to launch cyber warfare against the United States?
Not just Russia, others. Mm-hmm. And the potential for damage is phenomenal. Equals, possibly exceeds, you know, one or two nuclear bombs. You can pretty much incapacitate a whole country if you hack the right systems. And you that is what I'm worried about. I have a background in information technology besides having been a spy, and I know a bit about that stuff, and this is much more dangerous. And, you know, the political wrangling back and forth, I don't like it. It shouldn't be done, but that's a fact. Mm-hmm. But I think the danger is really for us to not focus on the real issue, which is cyber warfare.
You think we're being distracted?
Yes, we are.
Intentionally so?
Yes, we are.
Ready.
Oh, the last top five story this hour. The German foreign minister says now Turkey is away from EU membership more than ever before. Sigmar Gabriel says he always had doubts about Turkey joining the EU. He warned politicians that could be banned from holding rallies in Germany if they fail to abide by German laws. Meanwhile, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan says he hopes Parliament would restore capital punishment. The European Union has warned that Ankara's EU bid will be terminated if it restores the death penalty. The row between Germany and Ankara reached an all-time high after Germany barred Turkish ministers from holding rallies to promote the upcoming referendum in Turkey. The vote is meant to give President Erdogan sweeping powers.
fliegen.
Palmetto police say Freeman's car has been found abandoned in Ashland, Kentucky. Law enforcement there are now questioning two suspects, 21-year-old Kayla Coyler and 26-year-old Roy Nichols Jr., who they say stole that car. Coyler is Trisha Freeman's daughter.
This all happened this morning around 7. Police on the scene say it happened near Desert Inn and Eastern. The driver and passenger of one car were taken to the hospital in critical condition. The suspect in that car will be charged with DUI with substantial bodily harm after he's released from the hospital. The other driver in the second car was not hurt.
CBS 2 cameras captured the aftermath of the shooting on Hollis Avenue and 200th Street. Police say they stopped a suspicious car when the suspect sped off, hitting a police officer. Police later found the car parked 5 minutes away, but the suspects were nowhere to be found. The officer who was hit is expected to be okay.
The Cincinnati Police Homicide Unit is investigating a deadly shooting in Madisonville. The victim has now been identified, Tyrone Frazier. His body found outside a home near the intersection of Rose Street and Jameson Street this afternoon. Frazier was rushed to the hospital where he was pronounced dead. Police tell 9 on Your Side they have identified the shooter.
In Lowell, they've responded to 6 near-fatal overdoses since Thursday. The victim survived only because of the drug Narcan. District attorneys and fire departments are warning people to be particularly careful this St. Patrick's Day weekend. They're encouraging those who know people struggling with drug addiction to make extra phone calls, check in on them, and have Narcan.
I feel as my right and responsibility as a Muslim, as an immigrant, and as a human being, it's my right and responsibility to express my anger at the right-wing rhetoric that's being pursued today. And this is, I think this is just what today is about.
The attacker was shot dead by security forces inside Paris-Orly Airport. He had tried to grab a female soldier's gun when her colleagues on patrol intervened. Soon after, police evacuated thousands of passengers and staff from the South Terminal. Eyewitnesses described the panic which followed.
He was holding her by the neck. At the same time, he was holding her arm and he was holding the weapon of the soldier. And then, well, when we realized it was serious, we ran away. We went down the stairs and then we heard 2 shots.
I looked around. It was full of soldiers. You had people everywhere. Then we got in the hall and we heard gunfire. It was really scary.
The attacker was known to the police and intelligence services. Earlier, he had fired at a police officer north of the capital.
Ce matin, il y a eu une double agression.
There's been a double attack this morning by the same man, first against a police vehicle. There's been an exchange of gunfire, and there's been a second attack in Orly against the military. I want to pay tribute to the courage and the remarkable behavior of the security forces who have neutralized the man, doing so in extremely delicate conditions, as it was at Orly Airport.
Airport authorities temporarily suspended all flights. Access roads were blocked, and there was confusion as people tried to reach the terminals. What?
I think the first victory is that Milo Yiannopoulos is not coming to this university, which I think is a good thing,